And so Horner writes a pianissimo high F on Field of Dreams, which literally the books say it's not, because he knew what the books didn't know, which is that it actually is possible.
What do you got lined up for us today?
It is, in fact, not remotely related to what we're saying so far. I don't know.
It's
I'm sure I could find some sort of thread, but this is one I've wanted to do for a while, because it's a different way of organizing a few different pieces, different composers, all different types of music, really. But I thought a fun way to kind of gather some things together is that less than the composer themselves as the reason why to do it, it's because what they wrote gave a particularly awesome platform to the performers. So what I mean is these are pieces that all have in common. They are especially amazing performances by the musicians that recorded them. Like they're things that have always inspired me, because I heard that and I thought, you know, just when I thought I knew how to write for XYZ instrument or whatever, I heard something that was just genuinely mind-blowing.
I actually have a couple of examples of this.
Well, I wish I had them queued up.
Oh. Yeah, I can't. There's two that come to mind. And I'm curious to see how mine differ from yours.
Yes, hit me.
I was never a fan of Bach. No reason why. I think I got burned early on to where I was just like, I don't dig harpsichord. And I used to fall asleep listening to the classical radio station in Dallas. And I remember waking up in the middle of the night. It was just some weird, I mean, it probably wasn't even harpsichord. What's the other instrument that he was famous for? It's like the minuet or
like
whatever.
Like a clavinet.
Yeah, it was just a something et. And it was just this weird, it felt like something that belonged to the macabre or horror. And so it left me like waking up, you know, and it wasn't cool.
They're also often very, because they're instruments that have such short sustains, they basically, it's like a guitar that just go bink and the note is decayed and gone. Yeah. They tend to compensate for that by being very notey and busy. And there's a lot of density to the material because unlike an organ, or voices at the time, or strings, or something, you couldn't sustain the notes, and so all the Bach preludes and things like they're wildly dense and.
So I had relegated him to that. I was like, Bach was kind of like the YYZ, Tom Sawyer.
What?
What's the name of that band? I'm so tired right now.
Why
that band? Everyone's screaming. If you kept this in, you're screaming at me. What is the name of it? Rush. Jesus Christ.
Oh.
Bach was kind of like the Rush of his day, where it's like
names.
Very, very heady rock and roll. By the way, here's another tangent. Just follow me on this. I hear this notion a lot, like John Williams, Hans Zimmer, James Newton Howard, Thomas Newman, all the people that we've talked about on this show. They are the modern versions of Beethoven, Bach, Mozart.
Yeah, you hear that a lot.
That is such bullshit. They are not. I would say like Radiohead is the modern version of Bach. Or
the problem is it's really hard to. I don't know that I would actually agree that
Mac
Radiohead
is the new version of Beethoven, because Beethoven played stuff that was considered blasphemous and was shut down because it was so avant-garde and offensive.
That's not as true about Beethoven as some of the later, like Stravinsky is, you know, kind of the most famous for literally inspiring, you know, like a riot at the premiere of The Rite of Spring and stuff. But I think the biggest distinction would be the composers, like Radiohead would almost be the modern equivalent of, you know, Charles Ives or somebody who was genuinely kind of avant-garde and making people disturbed. Although way more recognized in their time than he was. I think one of the biggest distinctions, what I started to say, was that a lot of the, in one way that I would actually argue, you could say that the John Williams and the composers, especially in film, are similar to Beethoven, and especially, you know, composers like Bach, are that they, almost all of their music was a gig, was written on commission. They were told it should sound like X, Y, and Z. Like Bach famously, you know, had essentially a church job and had to write new masses on a regular basis, and organ music, and and sacred choral music, and all these kinds of things, where it wasn't, in contrast, you know, one of the reasons Brahms stands apart from so many of the of that era was that he largely didn't rely on commissions. His music became popular when he was young enough that the sheet music publishers would put it out and it would reliably sell, and he basically just wrote what he wanted to write and could self-sustain without having to accept commissions for new works. But he was very atypical in that regard. So it's like, to me, that's a meaningful corollary. But sure, in terms of like where they are creatively and relative to kind of like you said, if it's blasphemy or not.
But like Diane Warren could be considered the same thing, or you think about, I mean, Willie Nelson. Think about like a lot of the people that wrote, people are like, holy shit, he wrote that or she wrote that? It's like, yeah, like these were people, guy from Ryan Tedder, you know, he is, sure, he obviously had an incredibly successful band, but now he's known mainly as the go-to songwriter producer for pop music.
Right.
So those are kind of the same thing where it's like commission gigs. That's a whole separate conversation. Bringing us back to
what were Bach, the pieces you were going to mention? Yeah, you were saying Bach didn't...
There's two. One was Gabriel's Oboe as performed by Yo-Yo Ma.
From the We All Love Yo-Yo Ma album.
Dude.
I mean, the We All Love Ennio Morricone album.
Yeah. It's like, what? I think I'd heard that piece before, but even the Sergio Leone stuff that he did where it just became... I was fascinated by, and I mean, listening to Tina Guo and watching Tina Guo. Hearing Tina Guo is one thing, but it's watching her play.
Oh, yeah.
In the same way, almost kind of contrary to Yo-Yo Ma, because Yo-Yo Ma is far less. You know, Lindsay Sterling does a completely different thing. She's like, it's a performance artist, right?
Yeah, right.
Tina Guo, it's not an affectation. She is playing the cello and the cello is playing her.
Yo-Yo Ma is, in a way, not far behind her in that way, though. He's more physically reserved. But what I love is that he always projects. He always has this big smile, and he always has this like this vibe of, I am loving making music right now. It doesn't matter what it is. It can be him doing his, you know, goat rodeo stuff with Chris Thielen and like stuff that's not remotely classical music. Or it can be him playing, you know, 7 years in Tibet with John Williams, or it can be him playing, you know, the Elgar cello concerto or any other sort of straight-faced classical music. And he always just has this energy of, I am in this moment, and this moment is amazing. Mm-hmm. And I've just loved that about him. He does it because there's such a pervasive idea that serious musicians should, you know, sort of be a vessel for the sound alone, and their body is purely to facilitate the sound. And the idea that their body would sort of independently react to the emotions of the music is absolutely, you know, anathema to the actual art. And I think that that's ridiculous. And I'm so happy that someone like Tina has found career success essentially continuously saying fuck you to that sort of more conservative way
absolutely.
Of being.
I remember being at Roger Waters' show, and Roger Waters was played with the same kind of wonder and amazement, like looking out, we're at the Hollywood Bowl, and he's looking at it, he's like, I can't believe you people showed up. Like, that was the energy that he had. Was like, isn't this cool that you guys are still singing, you know, whatever song 40 years on, 50 years on?
Yeah, I love that.
The second piece of music, I'll never forget this. We stayed at this hotel in Rome called the Hassler, And the Hassler is a historic hotel that stands at the top of the Spanish Steps. And so Rome is a city that is most beautiful at night. Like it feels like an amusement park. It's just the way that the light hits it. It's just beautiful. You have all of these fountains. It feels old. It's great. Rome during the day is fine. I love London during the day, Rome at night, and Paris is the only city that delights at both. but we're sitting and we have this beautiful balcony that overlooks the Spanish Steps, and the city gets very quiet at night. And so it's like 10 or 11 o'clock at night. And at the time I still smoked, and I was out on the balcony and I was having a cigarette, and I just was playing a stupid game on my iPad, and instead of the audio of the game, I was listening to classical music, and I just kind of let it play. And all of a sudden
that leaves me a very conflicted feeling, but continue.
There's a lot of stuff that was happening. Why not just, I mean, if I was, I probably just said I was just staring wistfully off into the mid distance, smoking a cigarette overlooking the Rome landscape. But I was just, there's actually a picture of me just kind of like folded arms, like, you know, Bukowski with a cigarette like this. And I'm just like, but I'm listening, and all of a sudden, I hear this, the solo violin begin, in a track I'd never played before, and it kind of stirred me out of my, you know, playing a stupid game. And it was just a very simple, almost like a waltz feel with a solo violin, and then out of nowhere comes this very powerful voice of a diva. And I'm not a huge opera fan, but the dance that this and the emotion and the passion in which she sang, I instantly started crying. I was like, this is so, and it was German too. And I was like, ah, man, there's so many of these things that I normally would say, oh, I don't like those, but I'd never really experienced them. And it was Herbame Dick, part of St. Matthew's Passion. But it's this specific recording, because I've listened to other versions of it. I'm like, nah. All of those feel like the cover of this one, even though this is a very temporary or contemporary recording of it. But man, to this day, it's like the one that I was just on set, and the director and I got in a conversation about music, and I was like, you got to hear this. you got to hear this version. I sent it to him, and he was just like, oh my God, it's so moving. And there's multiple pieces now within that. I don't know what you would call that. It's not a concerto, but what would that St. Matthew's Passion be?
It's called a passion. That's the genre of that. Like, it's essentially, you know, liturgical choir and orchestra works that are very much about like a sort of, you know, religious setting of the various psalms and things like that.
It is still to this day like one of my, like I would even put that on like Desert Island. Like if I could have that, it would be that. So
that is absolutely the sentiment of what I mean, where the notes themselves are great. It's a nice piece of music, but there's something about the performer elevating it into a realm of something even more special. And so there's a few I've got teed up here. Some are like you're describing, where it's a soloist who just brings a magic, and others is about the congealing of the ensemble into pure magic. This first one I'm gonna play is legendary amongst LA studio musicians. It's French horn solo over the title, literal just black screen, white text of the opening credits of Field of Dreams. Ooh. And James Horner did the score, and he wrote this French horn solo that was played by a legend who's, I think sort of semi-retired from session work now, but he's still around in LA named Jim Thatcher. He's played on hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of prominent scores. And when I was in school, they always said the French horn, you know, it can play quite low. You can comfortably go, you know, an octave or two octaves even below middle C. But the octave above middle C, that one octave higher is just about the highest note you want to comfortably write, unless you're talking about a high level professional. That was what I came to believe as a 18 year old first kind of getting into the weeds on orchestration. And they said, you can go, you know, to high E if you're really pushing your luck and you've narrowed the field of horn players down to very, very, very few of the top. You're talking, you know, the top LA players, the top London players, a few others that can reach that high. And then the high F is, you know, all but unattainable except to a select few. And on top of that, the instrument can only hit that note if it's blasting at fortissimo. There's no way for them to play that note softly due to the physical design of the instrument. And so Horner writes a pianissimo high F on Field of Dreams, which literally the books say it's not, because he knew what the books didn't know, which is that it actually is possible. And so this Jim Thatcher horn solo is the stuff of legend amongst studio players.
That is writing narratively. Go. Pan flute? Yeah. Or is that synth?
No, he had these. There's a whole fun story about those flute players, too.
The choice to use a synth pad, though, there.
With
so
the strings, yeah. Horner was doing a lot of that in the 80s. Still coming.
What an incredible movie this was, too.
And then that's where his voiceover comes in as we come up from black. That, it sounds like nothing. It doesn't seem like a big deal. But if you ask any brass player, especially any that were there that day, that was like, you know, they had to all but hold back from a standing ovation for him because the cue keeps going and they have to keep playing. But it is one of those moments where every textbook on the planet says that's not possible.
You know, obviously it's probably impossible to know, but unless you do know the story, when you would record a solo instrument like that, is it, all right, Jim, this is your moment, but the rest of the orchestra is there, or do you bring him? Holy shit.
That's why it's such the stuff of legend, because there were people who were just sitting there with their jaw on the floor listening to this thing go on right in front of them. Yeah, that is often the case, especially with orchestral solos where, you know, it might, because it's usually typically the case where you might say it's a 5-minute cue, you know, there's some subsection of it that really features the soloist. So the musicians kind of, you know, listen for that and then they have to come back in and keep playing their parts. And there's always, you know, like they'll often run it. One of my favorite little orchestral musician things is, they'll do a run through of it just to kind of, and I wouldn't be surprised if they sent that cue to, they sent the part to him, a day or two early to say, you really probably should take a look at this before we are on the stage, which is rare. But when they know something's wildly difficult, they'll do their best to accommodate that if there's time. I don't know if that was the case. I'll have to ask him or someone else who was there. But when they run it while the red light's not on, or they know it's not the final take, the musicians often they do this little foot shuffle, so that's like in to avoid clapping because they're often playing. But as their little sort of like salute, you know, holy shit, man, you just crushed that. I've always been charmed by that in rehearsals or in those first readings where the musicians all kind of do the little foot shuffle of admiration for one of their colleagues. And I can't imagine that
really
didn't happen that day. Yeah.
Man, there's just a whole layer of, I suppose that there's an equivalent to that for as far as performance is concerned, because you're in front of an entire cast, an entire crew. There's a camera on you. You have to perform, but there's still, I don't know, man. The stakes seem to be a little bit higher for musicians. But I'm still stuck on the fact of Horner's ability to go, this is what I've always taken for granted, is that it's just write a pretty song, right? Just have them, what makes you feel this way? But for him to write on such a, I use this very, very carefully, meta level that says, this movie is about accomplishing the impossible. It is about daring to place yourself into a position of a dream.
That's a really interesting interpretation I honestly hadn't thought of. The idea that the horn solo is like this little microcosm of the narrative of the film.
100% it is.
In a meta way, though. This shouldn't be possible, but, you know, build it and they will come. I wish we could ask him. That is something that I would be so interested to know if that was just purely subconscious or if there was a conscientious... I want to do something that requires the reach because it embodies the film. I don't think of him as the kind of guy to do that. Hans Zimmer is the kind of guy who absolutely would come up with an idea in this sort of meta way. I don't know that I can think of any examples of Horner doing that, but it's a fantastic take. I love that.
Yeah, for it to be the opening of the movie, it's like, from the offset, most people will not get this. But if I do this right, if I pull this off, somewhere in Des Moines, Iowa, a 17-year-old who's learning how to play the French horn is going to hear that and go, no fucking way. And is going to appreciate rest of this movie on a level that nobody else could.
Because it's the main titles and it's the part with the actual credits before the movie starts, it's naked. There's nothing else in the audio. It's not like it's buried in the mix. There's no not hearing it. It's the first thing when, you know, the Paramount or whichever logo goes away, it's the first thing up. I'll have to ask some horn buddies of mine who would have been about that age, you know, and would have potentially heard that and said, that I want to do that for a living. Cause there's a million, you know, horn players that are now, you know, in their 50s and 60s who were kids when they saw the binary sunset and heard that French horn solo and said,
right,
that's what I want to do. I mean, that's one of those solos that just, it begat a lot of horn players. And I wouldn't be surprised if this is too.
Even outside of that, it became a print for, if you want to evoke this emotion, this is the instrument to do that. Like, we've talked about this before. I think I said it was the bassoon or the oboe is the most sentimental of all instruments.
Yeah.
Because I associate that with certain things that I consider, you know, to be sentimental over.
Mm-hmm.
Out of the gate with a fantastic. All right, so what's that?
All right, next one. Actually, and what you were just saying in terms of associations is a great. That actually is a really excellent segue to this one. This is John Williams, one of the lesser appreciated, probably rightfully so, Spielberg films. This is The Terminal, the movie with
Tom
Hanks and Catherine Zeta-Jones, where he plays Victor Navorsky? Victor Navorsky from the country of Krakosia. And Williams wrote this title theme that's sort of his character's theme that prominently features a clarinet solo. And that's a very intentional choice because he comes from a fictional Eastern European country, like, you know, Croatia, Lithuania, Slovenia, that vibe. One of the Enias. Krakosia is the one here. And so he wanted to write something that has a distinctly Eastern European, which is definitely always like, even if it's not literally Jewish, there is Eastern European music is almost, depending on which you're talking about, it can be almost synonymous with Jewishness and Jewish music. And likewise, the clarinet. The clarinet is deeply associated with like klezmer
Jewishness.
Music and things like that.
I don't know if that's exactly
Jewness. No, it's true though. It's absolutely true. And so he wrote this spectacular clarinet solo. And again, I don't know how the orchestra didn't just break into applause. Emily Bernstein is the name of the clarinetist. She sadly died from cancer not long after recording this, but one of these musicians who played played clarinet on a million sessions. But this one, John Williams wrote for her specifically, this clarinet solo. Listen to this. Thank you. Such control, so delicate. Very Williams right here. It brings the accordion, which is always so fun.
Would have never placed that as accordion.
It's because it's blending it with the flutes and the orchestra. And then here's accordion and clarinet together.
Such an association with, I would, you know, accordion can either be one of two, Eastern European, or I put it squarely in Paris. Like, to me, it is like a wholly endemic instrument to Paris. A Vion Rose or whatever being played, and it's just,
oh, sure.
Edith Piaf and an accordion is all you need.
But it's, and then it moves on for that. So it's, yeah, and she's featured all through that score, but that's one of those where, again, probably an 80-piece orchestra and having to just rock it with your colleagues watching, you know? And it's just so spectacular.
And they're restrained. They're clearly behind her.
Oh, yeah, and it's definitely, you know what I mean? She's like, the solo.
100%, but they're... imagining this immense orchestra that's behind her, clearly. Mm-hmm. But it's just, she takes a few steps forward and they're right there with her.
Yep.
The other thing that I really got to give, I have to think that John Williams is thinking about this, because obviously there's so many microphones that go up in a studio recording session. And I always think about multi-tracking, right? Mm-hmm. So multi-tracking is going to be...
Which Williams almost never does.
Multi-track? Yeah.
Meaning like overdubbing?
Yeah, so like, you know, if I do a standard, you know, 4-piece rock band or whatever, I'm gonna do bass and drums together, maybe rhythm guitar, so I get my rhythm section out of the way, and then I'm gonna do my lead guitar overdubs,
right?
And if I'm gonna put
and
keys,
your vocals, and right,
and then, but those things all exist in their own space, and then a mixer has to come in and go, this is gonna sound best if we put the keys over here. The snare needs to be typically just to the left, because that's where a right-handed drummer sits, so that it gets out of the way of the vocal. So being able to put stuff, but when you're doing an orchestral session like that, where those instruments live are where they live, mm-hmm. right? You can't remix that and go, you know what? I want those cellos to be actually over here off the left. They exist as they were. Pretty sure I got my right headphone in. So the ability for John Williams or any composer really to be able to go, think about where these instruments are happening, because there's a relationship sonically that's happening between in a stereo vision or a stereo image between right and left. And this is happening over here, but then this happens over here. So it's not just writing, it would be cool if the cellos did this and then I heard some flutes do this, but it is, or the strings doing this, it's which strings are playing so that they are creating this push and pull between your right and your left ear.
Absolutely.
100%. But that happens on the score sheet.
Yeah, I think you're not wrong at all to say that he surely is thinking about that kind of thing, because Williams absolutely thinks from the perspective of the podium, and so your relationship with these musicians is, you know, some are really close to you, some are at the far back side of the room, some are way over here, some are there. Like you can't not think in those terms when writing this kind of music.
Okay, so like if in directing, like, Camera language is so important. It could be a conversation about, I always use this as a great example, the diner scene in Heat. Mm. the position of camera and the setting of that is so much more integral to that scene than even the dialogue. The dialogue is so simple, so banal.
Mm-hmm.
But it's so powerful because of the context. So you could take, Mr. Robot did a great job of doing this too, sometimes a little bit too overtly, but depending upon where you put the camera, if you want to do a high angle camera, all of a sudden that scene is going to feel a certain way versus a low angle or a two shot.
Think of like the interrogation in Basic Instinct with the way the camera's moving so much on Wayne right. Knight's sweaty head and all that. You know, it's absolutely telling the story more than anything else.
So that is the difference between, you can write a script, but this is why a lot of, and I did this a lot too, the mistakes of early scripts are camera pushes in and we see, it's like, yo, if you're not directing that, then stop.
Yeah,
that's
right.
Not your job. There's a difference between a script and a screenplay. So camera direction has no business in a script. But here, a composer is writing the script and the screenplay because you would have to be in a situation where you go, okay, this is a moment of intimacy. Do you write? I always thought that was just, well, then make one instrument softer or whatever, or make it a solo instrument versus a big lush thing. But are you saying you actually will go, or maybe it's just John Williams that does this, to the relationship that I or he has at the podium to that instrument, if he's wanting to sell the lost, forlorn, separated from whomever, your family, feeling isolated and alone, he could choose an instrument that's further away from him?
Yeah, I mean, I think, yes, certainly in my case, yes. In his case, I think it may be a matter of just thinking in terms of the practical realities of, you know, what, like, how do I wrangle this orchestra most effectively, knowing that some people are closer to me than others? Because I don't think of him as a producer, like in the George Martin sense, where he's also thinking in terms of the character of the microphones and their placement. I could be wrong. I could be underestimating him, but I think of him as a bit classical, where it's more just, I want to create the perfect sonic image of this orchestra. But I mean, if you listen to like the Banner Saga, for example, that's all, you know, like the tree above the podium and really wide surrounds. We don't do any close miking anywhere in that score because I wanted it to feel like it's echoing through a canyon practically, as opposed to like Journey, which is very intimate and close, or Assassin's right. Creed, which is even more so. Assassin's Creed, we have practically no deca tree or I mean, we did have a tree, but we barely use it. It's a series of soloists that are inches from the mic. You know, I wanted something really visceral, you know, where you can feel the bow right up against your ear. And Banner Saga is the hard opposite of that. So, you know, Williams, I think he's, my summation of his, you know, just from interviews, is that it's more about creating the perfect sound of the orchestra as this sort of, as this unit, and his mind, what that is sort of the 19th century idea of what that is.
So will a composer then go, Harry, I need you to move? Or is it that you're writing for whoever happens to be in third chair or whatever of cello? You know what I mean? Like, does it fall on whoever that person is? Or have you ever had a situation when you're like, I need you to actually move because I need you to do something here at bar 64 that I really am leaning on you to do? Does that make sense?
Yeah, I mean, if I'm writing a solo, that stuff is all known in advance. Like, I'll tell Kempster or Jake or whoever's engineering, you know, oboe is gonna have a big featured solo in this one. Be ready up front, because they hate being caught off guard by that, because they want to make sure that they can capture it a variety of ways so that we've got flexibility in the mix, and also that they're prepared for it and they're also listening for it, you know, so that if it's not coming through, they can flag it and we can stop the take immediately because they already know we're off target, that sort of thing. So I'm always flagging that stuff ahead of time, but I can't think of any instance where I have or where I would reshuffle a section, for example, because those are careful, like fourth cello, move up here or something like that. Those seating arrangements are arrived at through their own kind of protocol, and that's something worked out usually internally by the section leader based on blending, and even may go down a rabbit hole of like, I'm playing this type of cello, which sounds nice next to your cello as standmates. you know, blah, 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 blah. There's a lot of nuance. And that's something that you completely defer to your section leaders for. Like, that's you tell but your I've principal, cello, viola, et cetera.
I've watched you work. I've had the opportunity to sit in and watch you do sessions. Your rehearsals are to tape. Like, they're like, that's great. Yeah, let's just get it again. And then you'll come in and refine, and you'll hear things that obviously I don't. But it's not like, I mean, I've been in a studio session before where it's like, I don't know, man, let's, and there, the song is being written in front of you.
Right. Yeah, that it's we being never created. Do with orchestras.
But how is that possible where it's never, like, I think you've told me some stories before where it was, there was a little bit more experimentation than normal, and it was one of the, I can't remember who the composer was that it was actually conducting, and he had them play through it over and over and over and over and over again, to where it was him getting exactly what he heard in his head out. But I it doesn't seem like,
usually that's about drilling. Like, the one story that you're probably referring to was when I kept hearing about how Alexander Desplat on The Curious Case of Benjamin Button made the harpist Katie Kirkpatrick play a long harp solo in front of the rest of the orchestra. There were no other, it was a purely unaccompanied harp solo. And he made her play it take after take after take after take for like 90 minutes or something crazy. And it was always technically perfect, but he was being just precise down to the subatomic level in a way that's seemingly just at some point, you're not actually making substantive changes. Although all the musicians I spoke to who were that day feeling a lot of pain afterward, they heard the final recording and they were like, fuck if we don't sound great though. Like, you know, there was method to his madness because that recording is just unimpeachable.
Because we're talking about solo artists and we're talking about specifically putting a spotlight on a particular instrument being played by a particular person. Mm. How much creative authorship or agency do you give to that soloist? Like when you have Tina Guo come in, or you would have Yo-Yo Ma or whomever, you're like, you get them to do what they do, but how much of it is you get them because they are able to somehow intuit what was in your mind when you put those notes on that paper? Or is it more, here is the idea, I would love for you to see how you interpret this. How much agency and authorship do you give that soloist?
It depends entirely on the piece. Sometimes because of certain situations, like depending on what it is they're recording, there can be very minimal agency, you know, subtle colorations. Like, you know, in the case of cello, someone like Tina, it might be she's playing up really high. And, you know, I'll ask her, you know, the four strings of the cello are C, G, D, and A. And I'll say, you know, can I hear that on the A string or the D string? They're slightly different colors. They're slightly different finger positions for her. And she might go, I think you're definitely going to prefer this on the D string. Here's why. But if we do it on this one, it'll let me do this. And she'll like, which might help for this upcoming section or whatever. And she'll help me shape it in a way where, you know, I'll hear what sounds most natural coming out of her, and that will invariably be the best version because it's the one that she's able to play most naturally and most you know, sort of fluidly. And that, but that's one where she's still navigating pretty tight fences, you know, of like the piece has pretty definitively written out part there. But there are other times where, you know, you might say, let's treat the line that I just put in front of you as a guide, but maybe we can play with it. And that can be about phrasing, you know, build a big crescendo and back off in a way that's not really on the page. And then suddenly realize, ooh, that's an interesting, I hadn't thought of shaping it that way. Or like even just string players deciding when, how much they can fit under a single bow before changing bow directions. Cause there's a different sound between up bow and down bow. And like, they might go, oh, you know what if I change bow here? Or like flute players will say, can I put a breath here instead of there, take my breath, then I can, as a result, get on beat three of bar four, I can really land that subtly in a way that I'll be gasping for air if I breathe at this other spot or whatever. So it's a lot of, even without changing one note or adding any degree of improvisation or whatever, not even opening that can of worms, we will end up in something that is wildly beyond just what an A flat on the page going to a G, going to a C or whatever would lend itself to be. It's taken on a character and a life through the conversation and through the experimentation. And occasionally it'll be, you know, even big changes. Like I remember on Journey, when recording the song at the end, I Was Born for This, I wrote the singer, Lizbeth Scott, who I could easily have done a bunch of pieces of her performances through the ages for this playlist today. Truly amazing solo vocalist and performer and composer in her own right, and she's very special. And she, I remember she's got this massively wide range, you know, she's like many octaves range. And I remember the solo of like when the big melody comes in at the end, you know, this da ni na ni na na na, the sort of Journey theme sort of rounds out that piece. It kind of fit so comfortably in the center of her range that we tracked it in octaves, so that there's actually two of her at the end in octaves with herself, because it was so easy for her to do that. And it wasn't written that way, though. It was one of those where I had written it the lower octave, and she's like, you know, I can hit all those high notes if you want to do it up there too. And it was like, well, yeah, you know, let's do it. And so then the result of which is that the upper octave pops a lot more in the mix. And so you'd think I wrote it that way, but it's actually was written for the lower, because I love the sound of her low range. Like I consider her a mezzo soprano, even though she can sing the highest notes any soprano can, but her kind of alto range is so rich and amazing that to me it was, you know, it's her down here. You know, that's like alto range, but she's also doubling it up in that range in the piece. So to that end, this next one is an example of the musician really effectively writing the piece, because as far as I understand, this was entirely improvised and then developed through conversation. So this is the aforementioned Hans Zimmer. I actually, Tina played on this. This was her first time working with Hans, and I texted her to say, there was a couple of violinists who played, this is on Guy Ritchie's Sherlock Holmes. And I said, which violinist played all the kind of like gypsy music? And because I couldn't remember. And she fortunately got back to me before we hit record today that it's this guy named Alexia Gutisman, who does a lot of different things. But this, as far as I'm aware, this was built in the exact way that you're describing. I could be wrong, but my understanding was that this was built exactly how you were describing, where it was like, okay, let's play a thing. And then it's all in the studio. And then, okay, now what if we tried this then? You know, in that third bar, you did this little lick that was fun. What if, and this is where Hans shines as a master producer, because this was not written out in any traditional way. Hans,
he's a rock guy. You know what I mean? Like he found himself first as that kind of, he was this rock producer, rock musician that came into it and was like, I'm going to bring that sensibility into this kind of
in every
venue
sense. As a recording engineer, you know, he changed a lot. We could do many episodes about Hans. We haven't really touched him in this series, but there's a lot to unpack about him. He's very polarizing, and I find it all fascinating. But there's no denying that he changed this art form forever. I think he changed it for the better in many, many, many ways. And so anyway, here's Alexia Gutisman, who hopefully I'm not totally butchering his name, doing this fabulous stuff from electric violin too, by the way. Character and what he's playing, you know, it's not just any violinist, it's that guy.
Right.
See what I mean? See, like, that's just not normal writing. It's what I love. It's right. It's so that's interwoven also, with the performer.
Well, not only that, but also it is so aware of the movie that it's being.
Oh yeah, well that's Hans's
for, right?
Hans never, ever, ever, ever betrays the film. He is a true film composer. He is connected to filmmaking.
But here's what I don't understand. He would have had to have either at least watched dailies, because, man, Robert Downey Jr. out of nowhere, right? Like he does Shane Black's Kiss Kiss Bang Bang, and it's like, man, we'd forgotten what a great, truly great actor. Like, monumental fuck up, huge addict, but an amazing performer and an actor that Robert Downey Jr. was. And then all of a sudden, that guy is just on top and unstoppable. And you go, wait. Robert Downey Jr. is going to be Sherlock Holmes? So I don't even know if it's just the casting choice made Hans Zimmer go, watch this shit. But the way or how much he knew about what Robert Downey Jr. was doing inside of that character, or even just the character that was being created through those movies that, you know, RDJ clearly inhabited, but that character was written. It wasn't just like, here are your lines, do whatever. But that means that Hans Zimmer had to go, I need an instrument that not only reflects that, but that I need a performer to be able to go, just run with it. But I need you to run on the rails that I'm giving you. Yeah. That's what I don't understand.
I don't know how he arrived at that, because I don't know the backstory, but I do know that he's always very plugged in. I don't know if he's watching dailies, but he often reads scripts. He's often having conversations while they're shooting, all that kind of stuff. I don't know if that was specifically the case here, but he, one of the things that you can never accuse him of also not doing is not experimenting. And he will, you know, spend hours and hours and hours developing ideas, even if none of it makes it in there at the end, just to find that one thing, you know. In this movie, one of the things that was so charming about that score was that it had this kind of like Fellini, almost Nino Rota kind of quality to it. And so the sort of gypsy band idea is sort of an extension of that. Like, let's bring this flair and this sort of sizzle beyond, you know, the obvious in every sense. I don't want to abuse your time, so I'm gonna play two quick more that are similar in nature.
Okay.
This is now, I've spotlighted soloists and or like in the terminal, you know, the soloist sort of dancing with the rest of the ensemble. But there is also times where the way that the orchestra comes together to form truly one unit is just breathtaking. And so one I've been dying to play for you since we started this, and I didn't know the right context because I just thought there's got to be some kind of, but this is my hero of heroes, Jerry Goldsmith. This is probably my single favorite score of his, 1975, The Wind and the Lion, Sean Connery film, directed by John Milius, old fashioned, you know, like romantic horseback riding and sword fights kind of movie. Kind of an odd movie, but Jerry wrote like he left nothing on the table with this score. Mm. And there's this scene that is so visually uninteresting. And I love how it's a scene of, you know, Sean Connery, who plays inexplicably, he plays an Arab in this film. Plays the Raisuli, who is running out onto this beach and fighting a bunch of British soldiers. And Jerry whips the orchestra into this ferociousness. Particularly, you'll hear there's this little line. It's got a very Eastern European, very Bartokian quality of this. You'll hear this, you know, dun da da dun da 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 da, just like this endlessly noodling. And it's not a vamp. It's not tucka 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 tucka. You know, it's a melody. It's just a melody with a billion notes. And what's so genius about this that I love, I would give anything to have a time machine to go back and see the look on the musicians' faces when they open up this cue, because it is a tour de force. Listen, close your eyes and just listen to the way that, you know, it'll be dun da da dun da 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 da, and then you'll hear the flutes, ba-dum-ba-ba-da-ba-da, and there's just so much dialogue happening within the orchestra, and then it's all setting the stage for, of all the instruments you could give this line to the trumpets, which is the ballsiest move, because you'll hear it is a wicked line to give to trumpets. And to me, I heard this when I was in high school, and it was just one of those, I'm not the same person anymore. Here's our violins. Here's the theme. Listen to the strings.
That's someone that's writing with, like, after doing a lot of cocaine.
He did drink a lot in that time period.
I mean,
of his life.
That's just...
It's truly amazing.
Not only that, but I could just, like you said, just opening up, oh, fuck you, man. And the thing that is, that was probably, what, a 2.5-minute cue?
It keeps going, but yeah, maybe 3 or 4 when all is said and done. And this is 1975, so, you know, you're talking, or 74 when they recorded it, I'm sure. So, you know, it's all to tape. It's all single take. It's all the full orchestra together. There's no click. There probably was a click, but there's no, you know, there's no overdubs. There's no punching in and out to get
together.
That one bar. Yeah.
And especially when you're talking about, like you said, those trumpets are moving together. So it's... We're wedded in this. If you fuck this up, like, that relationship to those people, as opposed to two guys on guitar, you know, kind of, I'll pick mine up later or whatever. I can do my vocals separately. Holy crap. All right,
I can top it with one last one that's actually even crazier in the same vein. Flash forward a little more than 10 years, late 86, I think. Temple of Doom. We're ending with John Williams where we started. So this is one of the, it's funny. Obviously, when he speaks with such big brotherly reverence about Spielberg, of course, how could he not? But every now and again, you'll catch a little snark from him where he says things like, you know, it's like when he does concerts, he'll say things like, it's so nice to perform the music without the troublesome sound effects and dialogue in the way. Because, you know, in contrast to Hans, who really is like, those things are part of the music. Like, I remember when the Hannibal, the sequel to Silence of the Lambs, came out, Hans included a lot of the Anthony Hopkins monologues as Hannibal Lecter on the soundtrack album, because he said, that's the score is fundamentally missing something if you remove his voice. Like it to him, again, film composer John Williams, for his many divine qualities, is definitely writing a piece of music to accompany a film. He does so better than just about anybody else, but there is a certain independence from the film that makes the music spectacular on its own, but also makes it sometimes probably a little bit cumbersome. Because if you watch this scene, this is the big mine car chase. The music is almost inaudible, but this is one of the most virtuosic pieces for orchestra, surely, in cinema. I mean, it is
okay.
Because it's in the same vein as what we're talking about. It's busy and it's complicated and there's a shit ton going on. And he does something really, I can't remember how many. This is something he doesn't normally do. It's a very Goldsmith move of him in many ways, although the music is unmistakably Williams. There's like three or four piccolos playing together, which is notoriously a stupid move because piccolo, like they always say, if you want two piccolos to play in tune together, you shoot one of them. Like it's always there. It's just an insanely difficult instrument to play in tune because, you know, it's up in the stratosphere. And he has a whole gaggle of them and they're in unison with the violins doing the fastest figures you can imagine. And it's all completely inaudible in the movie. This is Hollywood studio musicians. Again, sight reading. Every single member of the orchestra is working their ass off. But here we go.
Take a breath.
There's a 50,000 notes in that 10 seconds. And then it's not done. Drive by. A little glancing blow at the indie theme. This is a masterful piece of music. You see, he's following the movie really closely.
Yeah.
But he's telling such a story. Thank you.
Jesus.
It's unbelievable, isn't it? Could you imagine sitting down that day and being like, you know, probably, I'm sure Jerry Rotella was one of the, she's like the go-to piccolo player, you know, of all time and has played on every Williams score. They're close friends. And she and several other piccolo players just turning, and it would just page after page of looking at this and going, you know, all right, well, we've got till lunch. Let's do it.
That's it's also just what I don't understand when it's just a relentless cue. And who's turning those pages? You know what I mean? Like, do you have to be cognizant of that, of going, I can't have this run continue? Does it fall into your hands, or is it the orchestrator, or
it's the copyist? Yeah, it would be the copyist who is saying, you know, let's find a way to format these. And sometimes there are charts that are so relentless that they put these flat kind of cardboard boards on the music stand so that you can open up like four pages all at what, because you can, you know, if you're just reading a single line, four pages can, you could get 100 bars that way. And I wouldn't be surprised if on a cue like this, that's what they had to do. Because typically, when you ask who's turning the pages, it's actually a good pragmatic question, because often in strings, you'll see, you know, other than the cellos and basses, all the violins and violas are standmates. It's always two musicians per stand. So they always tag team, like one keeps playing and the other leans in and quickly turns the page for the other. So you'll see them, you know, meter that out. But but the rest of the orchestra generally is one player per stand. And so the part has to be written cognizant to where you can put those. And sometimes, you know, you'll do a cue where if the musician has a brief little pause, even if it's they play for 5 seconds and then they have a pause, if they don't have a pause again for a while, you might put just literally one bar of music on that page so that they then turn the page and then they realize, oh shit, I don't come in again for another 45 seconds, but I realize like they gave me this page turn here for a reason. Then they'll fan it all out and get ready, because that's part of why copyists are sort of the underappreciated heroes, because they have to analyze the music and say, what's gonna not fuck up the session, where you either hear a big loud page turn in the middle of it, or it's just literally
the musician
has to play straight through.
That's the other thing, is like being in the middle of a run like that is like, damn it, Tom, I had a Here's the thing, and this is me approaching a button.
I'm ready. Bring us out. You know, take it in for a landing. That,
every one of these conversations I walk away from, it's the awareness of, we appreciate, most people, myself included, appreciate something that is a true art form on such a surface level. And even that surface level is enough to win Oscars. Even that surface level is enough to be memorable, to make someone hum it as they're walking down the street. But what happens underneath the surface, for those willing like myself to go, let me ask you a question, and not only just have the willingness to ask, but also have the resource on hand to be able to go, how does this work? Makes me look back and go, here's what it ends up doing. It's empathy is the key, no matter what. Across the board, empathy is the key. If you want to know how you solve any problem, I would wager the guess is empathy. If somebody cuts you off in traffic, empathy is the key. You have no idea what that person is dealing with. They could be racing to deliver their child. You have no idea. So as opposed to me getting angry at it, empathy is the key. What it also helps me do is go, I'm not the only person on this set, in this booth, on this stage. There are a lot of other people. I'm not the most skilled person on this. And everyone's like, I know that I'm not the most important. It's like, but I found myself acting in such a way that made myself, you know, I postured myself in a way that said that I was the most important person. I would of course be humble and tell people, well, I'm not that talented. I don't have that. But it's also going, do you know how that thing works? Do you understand the level of skill that is required to operate that machine or to do that job? To be able to learn about this and what, out of an 80-piece orchestra, what that person sitting four chairs up and nine chairs over has to do for their job before lunch is just it really helps me realize how I fit into my specific job. And it may come down, maybe it's the big orchestra working together as a single organism, or maybe it comes down to a single soloist. That person where I listened to that piece on the Spanish Steps, I mean, will never know the impact that they had on me, but they forever changed the way that I looked at not only that song, that piece of music, that artist, but in music in general, to be open to something, to have a little bit more empathy.